We have with us Mr. Thyagarajan, Finance Minister, Government of Tamil Nadu, with us, and we're very happy that he's agreed to deliver this session. I had initially invited him to come during the day, but he said that he has assembly and this is a budget session and he would still be willing to come in the evening. He's had a long day in the assembly and he's just come back home. And I don't think he had had time to even take a glass of water, I hope. During the process of his talk, he'll have that. To introduce Mr. Thyagarajan, he's a graduate of NIT Trichy. He's also been a graduate from the MIT Sloan School of Management, as well as from SUNY, State University of New York, which is a fantastic thing because usually in a business school context, when we are holding a public policy conference, we are always at loss to bring the public policy and the business school context together. And who better than Mr. Thyagarajan, who knows both the worlds? He's been an investment banker, he's been working in Wall Street and Main Street. And for the last possibly 10 years, he's been in politics. He's been an MLA for the last session and this session, and he's been the principal spokesperson for anything which is related to finance and so on. And he holds a twin portfolio of finance and HRD, which is both relevant for us. So it's fantastic that we have somebody who has such a strong connect with the business school and the public policy realm, and willing to talk to us. Thank you very much, sir, for joining us today. It's fantastic that you've come. Just as a matter of introduction, we started off the conference this morning with an introductory speech by Dr. Mahesh Rangarajan, Vice Chancellor of Korea University. We have got more than 125 papers for the open track and about 30 papers for the special track proposals. We got around 150 odd papers, of which we have chosen 56 to be presented in two tracks over 2.5 days or 3 days, in fact. So this year has been particularly good for us in terms of the quality of papers and the number of papers that we have received. We are particularly pleased. Secondly, this is the 16th edition of the international conference, and we have had this uninterrupted for the last 16 years. Our biggest challenge was last year when we went completely online, but now all of us are veterans of life online. Hopefully, by the time we are in the next conference, I hope we'll be able to go back to our original format, and I hope we'll be able to get Minister Thyagarajan to our campus at some point in time and interact with him personally. The other highlight of this conference was a special focus on cooperatives. This is the birth centenary year of Dr. V. Kurian, famously known as the Milkman of India. So we have multiple papers that was presented. In fact, Dr. Mahesh Rangarajan also, pleasantly to my surprise, focused his talk on cooperatives and this thing. I hope Dr. Thyagarajan is going to talk about federalism. There is an element of cooperation, but that element of cooperation is different from the Korean brand of cooperation. But I'm sure there is a whole lot that we can learn from Dr. Thyagarajan's talk. Thanks a lot for agreeing, sir, and it's all over to you. Thank you very much.
First of all, thank you for inviting me. Thank you for the kind introduction. And if it's okay with you, you know, I've talked a lot about federalism in a lot of places, the GST and so forth. So I don't want to kind of repeat the same concepts here. I'm happy to take questions on it. And I will try and finish speaking, you know, fairly quickly. But what I thought would be really helpful, since I'm speaking to people at a management institution, is to talk a little bit about the complexity of administering public policy, of administering a government, and what we have learned from recent experiences both in India and around the world, and why I think we actually need a lot more professional and kind of a lot more investment in the basic concepts of administration as a country, as a state. Let me say that I'll start from a premise. When I came as an opposition MLA I assumed two things in 2016. I assumed one, that the complexity of governance would be a lot higher than what I had done in banking, where I'd served in very senior positions in large banks, though the quantity of money would be a lot smaller, just because we are in rupee country, in a developing country. You know, I had been trading hundreds of billions of dollars in the money markets back in 2001 at Lehman, and overseen 170 billion plus balance sheet as the global head of money markets at Standard Chartered in 2011, 12, 13, something like that. So I expected that while the money would be a lot smaller, the complexity would be a lot higher. But I also made the assumption that if you were in government, you had a lot more support and a lot more infrastructure and a lot more data than you had in opposition. And so it was just that we were outside the system and we didn't have it. And I assumed that one day, if I sat inside the system, like I did as the managing director of the bank, that all the systems would be there and all the data would be there. And the concept of institutional knowledge or memory or continuity was something I took for granted. And I would say the biggest shock I've had after coming to office as a minister in the last 3 months and a few days is that that's simply not true. I mean, the saddest part of administration, as best I can tell, is that we simply don't have anywhere near the infrastructure. We don't have the institutional memory. We don't have the institutional knowledge. And we don't have the continuity that a simple small business would have built into it. Let me explain what I mean by that. Of course, the democratic model is that every 5 years or, you know, some period in different countries, you have elections and the government changes. We know all that. But we assume that the bureaucrats and the rest of the government employees offer some kind of continuity. And therefore, you know, people may come and go. Of course, there's a learning curve to be a first-time minister. But, you know, there's always a trade-off that, you know, generally the older the hand, the more they're well-versed in kind of the rent-seeking and other behaviors also. So especially in a place like Tamil Nadu, every 5 years you had a change of this party, that party, with few exceptions over the last 50 years. And so the trade-off you get from having kind of discontinuity in administrative experience is also offset by the upside of having discontinuity in kind of other behaviors that are not good for society. And therefore, that your net result was that the politicians come and go, but then the system is the system. In fact, that's not true. In fact, I am appalled after coming to office to find that we have two huge, huge gaping holes. And the first gaping hole is this lack of institutional knowledge or institutional memory. Because really, you should see all government servants, government staff as two different levels. One is kind of the IAS cadre, you know, the both exam written IAS and the deemed IAS, who are the ones who are mostly in direct contact with the ministers. And then the second is all those below that. In the case of Tamil Nadu, they come from the Tamil Nadu Public Service Commission or through direct hiring or so forth. And that goes all the way from, you know, cleaners and office assistants all the way up to deemed IAS officers who can take the same jobs as exam written IAS officers. The problem is that the continuity and the institutionalization only happens below the IAS level in the government. Those are the people who are hired into one department and very often spend their whole careers in that department. Because as you know, in the IAS level, they rotate all the time. So it's very rare to find an IAS officer who's been in a seat more than 2-3 years continuously. And if I were to take a department, it's very rare to find an IAS officer who has been, you know, 10 years in one department in the course of their career through multiple rotations. And of course, the ministers keep changing. So if you really think about it, there's no, of course, you know, the workaround for this is to have such fantastic data systems and such good filing systems and such great kind of record keeping that people can walk into office and learn all the issues within a few months. In fact, that doesn't exist either. So if you take the combined effect of not having kind of good memory systems, good databases, good kind of, there's no such thing as a dashboard. I cannot understand anything about my department from a computer screen. I have to ask some secretary, then they have to write some note, then they have to send me some paper. Sometimes they may know, sometimes they may have come into the job 2 months before. of the top 7 or 8 officers in my department, for example, in finance, I think 2 of them are more than 6 months or 1 year old, and the rest have rotated in recently. Of course, the irony of this is that regime change also results in IAS officer change because of perceived or real nexus between IAS officers and political, you know, operators of different parties. So the net result is you have a system that is continuously in flux of human beings. And most of the people that you as a minister can speak to are not people of great depth in that department, certainly not of continuity for 10, 15, 20 years to have developed institutional memory. And so this lack of both human continuity and the lack of electronic infrastructure really becomes a debilitating factor and introduces huge complexity in the administration of a government or in the implementation of public policy. Now, some of this is supposed to be offset in the nature of our constitutional model. Some of this is supposed to be offset by the fact that we have a legislature that has a clear role. And that role, as envisioned in the Constitution, goes from basic things like committees that will, you know, standing committees that will address the issues, let's say, in Parliament, to vetting of bills, to internal communication, and then dissection of laws and proposed laws and so forth, to functional committees. For example, the reason I'm a bit rushed today, I've just participated in a training session for all the new MLAs in Tamil Nadu, where the topic given to me was to talk about the finance-related committees, which in Tamil Nadu are the estimates committee, or a forward-looking committee that tries to help the government frame the estimates for the budget for next year, public sector undertakings committee, which is a kind of real-time committee which helps with the administration of public sector undertakings like electricity, transport, water, et cetera. And then the Public Accounts Committee, which is a backwards-looking committee, which looks at the reports from the CAG about things that went wrong and tries to analyze how did they go wrong, why did they go wrong, who should be held accountable, and most importantly, how do we prevent these from going ahead in the future. So in the original design of the Constitution, there was a clear role for the legislature. And this role included all the way from actual legislation support, the creating of bills and laws, to administrative support through such committees, and through kind of sometimes cooperative, sometimes accountability holding role for the elected legislature. Now, already in a system like ours, there's a very close nexus because the government is formed by the party that has the highest number of legislators. So at some level, the legislature has already got a bias towards the administration by the nature of the democratic model we have. But at some other level, if their roles were truly as envisioned by the Constitution, then they add significant value in this public administration and public policy administration. Part of the problem of complexity is also the proliferation of institutions, agencies, boards, public sector undertakings. Politicians like to be remembered. Politicians want to leave their mark. And one of the easiest ways to do that is to come and create a special purpose vehicle for a special need. You know, for example, in Tamil Nadu, we have many, many different housing development corporations. By the sheer volume of entities to be administered, entities to be seen over. And the proliferation also affects your administration, because if you take Tamil Nadu, for example, we went from something like 200 plus IAS officers about 10, 15 years ago to 300 plus IAS officers or so today. But if you look at the entities, there are probably hundreds of entities. There are tens of districts. And there are always pressures to increase the number of districts, to increase the kind of number of taluks and the onryams and all that stuff. So you're perpetually expanding the scale of the organization, and you're not actually keeping up with the number of management people or staff or the overhead that you use to run these things. So the net result of all of this, I must say, the worst case outcome is what we often see, which is that the lack of adequate infrastructure, the lack of adequate management capability, the lack of adequate sophistication, continuity, institutional memory, institutional knowledge, results in effectively what I would call a failure of governance. And by failure of governance, I mean you're not able to achieve the things you really ought to achieve. You're not able to achieve
the real profound fundamental things you have to achieve, which is to increase people's quality of life, you know, improve the infrastructure and keep up, let's say, the government role as a function of GDP or GSDP, and make sure that people's, you know, there's inclusive growth, that everybody gets to participate in the growth. And so what happens is that we end up with relatively poor outcomes. And if you start with the fact that most of the administration, most of the elected officials who got to sit as ministers also were not particularly well equipped to do this, then you end up with this combined bad outcome of poor performance with poor or no explanations to the people. And in fact, I've commented elsewhere that one of the things that I've been startled by after coming to public life is that there's very little correlation, at least as far as I can see, between the attributes, the skills, the standing in society required to be you know, eligible to get a seat as a candidate of a major party in an election and to win that election in a public space, between the skills and attributes required for that, and you compare that to what is required to actually be a good administrator, let's say, you know, an MBA from IIM who goes and runs a big business, there's very little overlap between these two things. That's true even at the level of an MLA. There's very little overlap in my understanding between being a good legislator and being a good candidate, or being a candidate worthy enough to get a seat. Now you add that to minister and you have a problem that's even worse. And the consequences of poor outcomes mapped to poor explanations is what causes a lot of resentment in society, because people feel that they are excluded from the growth process, but they feel that only they are excluded. They don't realize that a lot of people are excluded, and it's a general failure. Everybody only sees their point of view. Of course, they realize that some people have benefited hugely, whether it is the plutocrats, the oligarchs, or as one of our advisors, Raghunath Rajan, wrote a book many years ago with his fellow professor from Chicago, Luis Ingalls, Saving Capitalism from the Capitalists. So what happens if a few capitalists get really successful, and then they figure out how to draw the bridge up and keep the moat around them through lobbying, through you know, influence of the political process, and it's no longer a level playing field, it's no longer an open market. You get so big that not only are you too big to fail, but you're too big to compete. You know, you can control the system and make it no longer a level playing field. It's now skewed, and the playing field is tilted the wrong way. So if that is a visible outcome, and there is a personal perception of a lack of progress or a lack of outcome, and this is combined with no explanation of why and how this loss came about, because nobody goes out and say, I tried to achieve this goal and it didn't happen because of this reason. Now you have all the kind of ingredients for a whole bunch of people to feel alienated and to somehow feel that they have been kind of, you know, cheated out of something. And I think this is not it is of course a developing country's nightmare, but it is also not uncommon to develop countries, because if you look around the world today for the last, I don't know, 5, 10, 15 years, what you see is an increase in the kind of anti-science, anti-intellectualism, kind of right-wing populism, sometimes violent, sometimes irrational, you know, the anti-vaccine kind of crusade, the Tea Party kind of, you know, as they say in one of the, you know, the US has very trenchant expressions. And one of them is said, the people are so angry that the answer is no. Now, what is the question? So you end up with that kind of alienation or that kind of a negative outcome. And, you know, you can see this all over the world. We've seen this in the US, we've seen this in the UK, the Brexit and the kind of now, the, you know, the full realization of the consequences, whereas the vote was more of a resentment vote. We have seen it in Europe, we are seeing it in a lot of places in India. So I think what we really at a crisis here is this mismatch. What it takes to administer effectively a system of the complexity that we have is much, much better infrastructure that we have, much, much better quantitative kind of systems, continuity, staffing, and delegation of responsibility across all the levels of administration of government, from the union to the states, to the districts, to the panchayats, to the cities, to the villages, etc. And since that is a really hard thing to do, it is a lot easier for most politicians to do the easy thing, which is to be populist, either populist in arousing emotion and making voting based on that, or populist in terms of announcing freebies or announcing schemes or, you know, pandering at the time of elections and say, I give you this plus that plus that plus that. Those are the kind of direct outcomes of a lack of actual governance, of a lack of actual progress. So I think, you know, we are now at a situation where we really have to question, why is it that the rest of the world understands these things clearly? All of you at IIM Bangalore or at any leading academic institution, indeed of any academic institution, understand that there is a concept of complexity, that there are established notions of things like organizational design, accountability, alignment of incentives, you know, infrastructure, data, analytics, etc. And so little of that is used in government, and so little of that is used in policy administration, that we are doomed to fail. I mean, it's not rocket science why we fail. We don't do the things we're supposed to do. And there's a clear solution. How do you fix this? You do what you're supposed to do. You do what decades of advances in science and administrative, you know, policy and management science and data and infrastructure and all these things have taught us. And, you know, then the question is, how easy is it to do that? You know, what are the natural forces aligned against these kinds of improvements? And how do you overcome those forces? And I think that's really going to be the key, right? Because not trying to do that is a guaranteed failure of an outcome. And it's going to be the more of the same. You have to do the right kind of appeasement or the right kind of, you know, arousing of spirits and you know, of obviously of negative spirits, of, you know, a lot of divisive spirits. And it's much harder to go and stand in elections and ask for votes based on, this is what I have achieved for you. This is how much your life has improved. This is how much, you know, you should measure me from where to where. And that requires a fundamental change. Thank you. So I think with that, I will probably conclude my remarks and be happy to take questions, which is probably more likely to be suited to your needs than what I might envision. Thank you.
There are a couple of things, you know, very clearly, I think as academics, we have been complaining that we don't get adequate data. I'm very happy to know that you as a minister also have a similar problem, not a happy situation, but both of us are equally at a disadvantage.